Welcome to Eastside Baptist Church on this special Sunday as we celebrate Easter, the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're so glad that you're joining us here today. We want to let you know about some things that we have coming up today and in the coming days here at Eastside Baptist Church. First of all, our ladies will have a prayer meeting this Thursday, April the 4th at 10:30 a.m. at the Memphis campus. Next Friday and Saturday will be our garage sale fundraiser for our young people going to camp. Donations are still being accepted at the Memphis campus, or you can see Brother Isaac for a donation pickup. Also, if you can help with setup during the sale or cleanup, please see Brother Isaac. We'd love to have your help as well. Next Sunday evening, our service will be at 5 p.m. After the service, we'll go out on door-to-door outreach. We'd love to have you join us for this time of outreach visitation. On Tuesday, April the 9th at 11 a.m., our senior saints will have their celebration. It'll be at 11 a.m. at the Memphis campus. Please sign up at one of the designated sign-up areas if you plan to attend. Once again, thank you for joining us today as we celebrate Easter together. At the conclusion of our service today, there will be an egg hunt for the children. Please be sure that when we dismiss, that you pick up your child and escort them to the designated area as shown here on the screen for their age group. And please do not run and be careful in the parking lot. If you are not involved in the egg hunt, please watch out for the children and let them get to their designated area before you exit the parking lot. Again, we're grateful that you're here today with us at Eastside Baptist Church. Now, let's worship the Lord together. Amen. Good morning. Good to see you here this morning. Let's stand together as we sing together this morning. Number 152 in your hymnal, Christ Arose, He is Risen. Well, that was a little weak. He is risen. There we go. Let's sing it out together this morning. Christ arose. Hallelujah. Christ arose.
Low in the grave He lay.
is risen indeed. So glad to have each of you visiting with us today. We're going to have a word of prayer in just a moment, but we have several visitors, several first time and several returning guests. If you would please, you can use your phone and scan that little scanner thing on the back of the bulletin. You can fill out a visitor's card that way, or you can stop by the welcome desk and fill out a visitor's card there. But we'd like to have a record of your visit with us. We also have a gift we'd like to give you for being here with us today. I'm glad you're here. I hope you're glad to be here. Thank God we have space issues. That's a wonderful blessing. Amen. And so thank you for inviting friends and family. And those of you that are here, thank you for coming today. It's going to be a wonderful day. It already has been. Amen. And let's ask God's blessing on the rest of the service today. Father, we are very grateful that we can gather together today and we can sing that song, He Arose. He is a victor over the dark domain. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to understand all that you went through so that you could provide us forgiveness of sin, freedom from sin, and a home in heaven. Lord, I pray that there wouldn't be a person that watches by webcast or is in the service today. Not one person would leave here without Jesus being their Lord and Savior. God, we ask that you would work in each of our hearts and lives, and we do praise you today because Jesus is risen. We serve a risen Savior. Thank you for that truth. Help us as we seek to worship him together today. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you.
take your hymnals once more and stand with me if you would. Number 150 together. We'll sing out together, "He lives, he lives. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today." Number 150, let's sing it out together.
I serve a risen Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice and cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always here. He lives, he lives, Christ Jesus. Lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know.
Last one, rejoice, rejoice. Because he lives inside of our heart, it should give us reason to rejoice if you're saved this morning. Let's sing it out together. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian.
Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian. Lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King. The hope of all who seek him. The help of all who loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know.
If you'll come, we're going to worship the Lord with our giving, and I hope that you can sing that song from the heart and mean it, that Jesus lives within your heart. If he does not, today could be the day. Amen? And it should be the day. I was sharing a gospel track with a lady yesterday, and she said, "Oh, I've been by your church." Actually, it was on Friday. She said, "I've been by your church. I was lost." And I said, "Well, you came to the right place, because we're there to help people get found." Amen. And she knew immediately what I was talking about. She even gave me a high five. She said, "That was a good one, preacher." And she liked that. So anyway, I hope. And this, I mean this with all seriousness. If you have never been saved, if you've never accepted Jesus Christ into your heart, I want to ask you to do that today. Give strong consideration to the fact that you cannot go to heaven without him. Your sins cannot be forgiven without him. And we need Jesus. You need Jesus. No matter how you feel about it, the reality is we need Jesus. And so today, if you don't know Jesus as your Savior, I want to ask you to please consider trusting in Him. I'm going to do my best to make a case for Christ here in just a few moments. And I hope when I'm finished, if you haven't made a decision, that by the end of the service today, you will decide for Jesus. Let's ask the Lord's blessing on the offering. Let me say one thing about the offering before we pray for it. I've encouraged our church family to give something extra for the renovation for the buildings over here. We need to get all of our classes and everything out here as soon as possible. You see how we're crammed in here today on a special day, and we're so glad you're here and you're a part of that. But eventually, we want to be able to build a brand new auditorium, turn this back into a gym. And so we've got all kind of things planned, and this is going to work well for now. But I pray with your help, we're going to outgrow this very quickly. And so we need to renovate over there to get our classroom space for all the Sunday school classes and everything, and then also have a new auditorium to hold more people for the Lord. Not because we want to be a big church. We want to reach people with the gospel. We want to see lives transformed. We want to be a help and a blessing. And we hope that this is a place that you can call home as a believer. Amen. And so we're glad you're here, and I hope that you will be back even after today. Let's pray for the offering. Father, thank you so much for your love and mercy. We do pray that you would bless not only the service today, but Lord, bless the people that are gathered here. They've taken time out of their schedule. Some of them maybe have a different church or here for family today. Some maybe they're coming because this is their church for Easter. And Lord, we pray that it wouldn't just be their church for Easter, but Lord, that we would be able to be a blessing and a help to them every Sunday. And Lord, we ask that you would use this place to glorify your Son and to make a difference in the lives of others. Lord, thank you for those that give to help us be able to continue the ministry of Eastside Baptist Church. Bless every gift and every giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Behold the cross where life eternal died. God slammed the Christ, the final sacrifice. No other blood removes iniquity. No other man redeems humanity. Take up your cross upon the Calvary road. With steadfast faith remain beneath the load. Consider all the suffering Jesus knew. Consider him whose grace will carry you. Embrace the cross and glory in its shame. With all your heart, live worthy of his name. Oh, follow Christ, regardless of the cost. Give everything to Jesus. Exchange your cross for heaven's great reward. Present your crown to Jesus Christ the Lord. Embrace the cross and glory in its shame. With
till every nation hears that for our sin the Son of God was pierced. In Jesus' name, go forth in gospel night. In Jesus' name, declare Christ crucified. Embrace the cross and glory.
Thank y'all very much. That's a blessing. Open your Bibles this morning to Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. We're going to start there, and then we'll be over in 1 Corinthians a little bit and look at several passages, but we're going to focus on some of these passages, of course, that are centered on the resurrection of Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. This is an extremely important thing. It is something that you and I need to comprehend. We need to understand how it impacts other doctrines. And most importantly, we must choose to believe it, and as a result of it, to receive Christ as our own personal Lord and Savior. And it is important to know who Jesus is and what he has done for you. Now, in your Bible, Matthew 28, we're going to read this account of Matthew, and the Gospels record the resurrection story of Jesus. I don't always like to use the word story. Sometimes people think, well, if it's a story, it's made up. This is a resurrection fact about Jesus, okay? And this was Matthew's account of that event. Beginning in verse 1, it says, "In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher," that is the grave. "And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came down and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it." Now somebody said, well, the angel had to roll the stone away so Jesus could get out. Absolutely not true. He rolled the stone away so that the women could look in. That's why that took place. Verse 3, "His countenance," the angel, "was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men." They passed out. "And the angel answered and said unto the women, Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is," what's it say? Risen. "He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulcher with fear and great joy, and did run to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, All hail. And they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him. Then said Jesus unto them, Be not afraid. Go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee, and there shall they see me." Matthew 28, 1 through 10. Now, one of the things you need to understand about the resurrection of Jesus Christ is this. If Christ did not rise from the dead, then Calvary means nothing. He was just another person that was crucified under Roman law. And so if Jesus did not rise from the dead, Calvary means nothing. But we know that he did. Now, I want to speak to you this morning, whether you're convinced of it or not, and I hope to encourage you to be certainly convinced, but listen, it's not enough to just know it happened. It needs to change your life. And that's what the resurrection, that's what Jesus, that's what Easter Sunday is really all about. It's all about our lives being changed because of who Jesus is and what he did for me. What he did for you. I want to have a word of prayer, and I've got 3 points, just 3 points this morning. Each one has about 175 subpoints, but only 3 main points. I'm teasing about that. But I will try not to keep you long today, but I want us to pray and ask God to help us with the message this morning. Father, we thank you for your word today. We ask that the Spirit of God would be our teacher. We invite you, Lord Jesus, to be a part of this service. We know that you promise where two or more are gathered together, you are in the midst of them, and if they're gathered in your name, and that's why we're here. But Lord, we also want to invite you. We ask that you would work within our hearts. I pray that believers would have their faith strengthened today. And Lord, if there's some folks here today, and generally in a crowd this size, there's going to be some people that don't have it settled for sure. Maybe they have some doubts. Maybe there's some here that just know, and they've come searching today. Maybe even watching by webcast, I pray that today would be the day they would see an empty tomb and a risen Savior. and recognize what it means for them. And we'll thank you for what you do today. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, my three points are these. I'll tell you what they are and then explain them. Number one, the resurrection is indispensable. It is indispensable. Okay? Number two, it is impossible. It's impossible for a man that's dead to rise from the dead. But number three, it's irrefutable. It's irrefutable. So let's talk about those three things. Turn in your Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, if you would. We're going to look at a few verses there in just a moment. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 12 through 19. The resurrection of Jesus Christ for the Christian faith is indispensable. There may be some things that we can kind of step back on and say, okay, I understand. You know, it's not such a big deal whether or not you meet in a gymnasium or an auditorium, you know. I had a guy one time in my church years ago, and we were just getting started, and we found a building that was really had come down in price, and we were wanting to buy that building, but they had a kitchen. And that guy said, the Bible says, if you're going to eat, you ought to eat at home. I thought, man, you're not a good Baptist. And he told me, he said, I'll never vote for a church that has a kitchen. And we sat down and talked about it. I explained to him why that was not the indication of what the Bible was saying there in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and so forth. And anyway, long story short, there are some things that we can kind of relax or we can be flexible on. There are some things that maybe you could consider them to be a gray area. But I want to tell you something. When it comes to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it is absolute. It is indispensable. It's something that we cannot yield even an inch on. It is paramount to Christian doctrine. The resurrection of Christ is indispensable to our Christian faith. It is the keystone of all other Christian doctrine. In fact, as I said earlier, if the resurrection did not happen, then Calvary is meaningless. It holds no meaning for the believer. This is the basis of what Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 when God directed Paul to write to the church of Corinth. It was a struggling church. They had some problems within the church. They were beginning to compromise on some very important doctrines. And so God inspired Paul under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and he wrote a letter to them in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. It's all about the resurrection, but I want you to know something. It's more than just that one part of it. In the first part of chapter 15, he defines the gospel. What is the gospel? It is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He died for your sins, he was buried, and he rose again the third day. And then Paul says, and he was seen. So he defines the gospel in 1 Corinthians 15. He defends the resurrection in 1 Corinthians 15. He defines the gospel, he defends the resurrection, he gives those eyewitness accounts. But he also does something very important to the church today, and that is he develops the doctrine of the resurrection. He begins to deal with all of the things that the resurrection impacts. He ties it to Old Testament promises and things that God said would be true. And if the resurrection is false, all of those other things are false. And so 1 Corinthians 15, 12 through 19, the Holy Spirit directs him to write these words. Now, if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? Now, let me just stop and say something about that. That tells you how false doctrine creeps into good churches. I mean, think about the person that we're talking about here, the Apostle Paul. He planted this church. He taught in this church. He preached to them. He trained the people that would come and follow him in ministry there. And yet there are some people within the church that were saying, there is no resurrection from the dead. And so Paul immediately begins to deal with that issue. He says, how say some among you? Now listen, folks, that tells me that we have to always be on our guard for doctrine to be sound. We need to make sure that what we are teaching and what we are preaching comes from this book. And can I tell you that it doesn't matter the title of the church or what you call the person that delivers the word, if they are not preaching sound biblical doctrine, get away. Just get away. And so you have Paul writing here. He's seeking to help them understand. It's a new church. It's a new work, and he wants them to be protected. He says, but if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. Yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. For if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins. What a powerful statement that is. Then they also which are fallen asleep, those that have died in Christ, are perished. If in this life, I've thought about these words right here so many times. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. Most miserable. Well, I want to tell you, there is hope. And Paul is writing to them about that hope. Here's a list of Bible doctrines that Paul deals with. It's not complete, but it is a list of some major doctrines he deals with here in 1 Corinthians 15 that literally rest upon the validity of the resurrection. The first one is very simple, and that is the gospel of Jesus Christ. If the resurrection is not true, the gospel is not true. We're preaching a lie, and that's what Paul says. Secondly, the divinity of Christ, the fact that Jesus was God in the flesh. If the resurrection is not true, if Jesus did not rise from the dead, he is not God, but yet he did rise from the dead. Romans 1:4 says that he was declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness, listen, by the resurrection from the dead. When Jesus rose from that grave, it settled any question about who he was. Not only the divinity of Christ, the gospel, but also the resurrection of the believer and the glorified body. You see, here's a truth that's being taught here in 1 Corinthians 15, and this is what verses 12 through 19 Paul is dealing with. The people there had loved ones that had died already, and they were discussing whether or not those people would be resurrected one day. And some people in the church were saying, no, people don't rise from the dead. And so Paul takes that concept and deals with it. And he said, if they're not going to rise, then Jesus did not rise from the dead. But listen, because Jesus rose from the dead, we too shall rise. Amen. You think about it. I got a text from my preacher brethren this morning. He said, when you drive by a graveyard on the way to church this morning, I want you to think about the fact that one day the trumpet will sound and people will come up out of those graves. I've stood at many gravesides and wept for the family and wept because the person that I love is no longer with us. But at the same time, there's a hope in my heart knowing that that person one day would rise from the dead. They'll never be sick again, never suffer again, and never have to face death again. That's a promise from God. And if Jesus didn't rise from the dead, all of that is naught. All of that is a lie. You see how many doctrines the resurrection touches? There's one more here, and that is the kingdom of God. The kingdom that Christ would found and be the head of. If Jesus did not rise from the dead, then that kingdom will not come. You might as well quit praying the Lord's Prayer, because it's not going to happen if Jesus did not rise from the dead. But you know what? I'm so thankful that verse number 20, Paul, under the inspiration of the Spirit of God, writes this. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. Listen, the resurrection of Jesus Christ is indispensable to the Christian faith. You cannot give an inch on that. Not an inch. There's so many that I could list, but that one is important, folks. It's mega important. So, number one, it's indispensable, but number two, it's impossible. There's a lot of things that the Bible tells us that are impossible, but by faith we believe them. I think about the creation of the world. You know, everybody has a creation theory, or they have some kind of theory about how all the world came to be, a first cause, if you will. And man, some of them are way, way, way out there. One of my favorites that's way, way out there is the one about the aliens that came down and laid eggs on Earth, and then eventually those eggs hatched, and that's how we got what we are. You know, I don't know if you've seen that one or not, but it's out there, folks. I want to know what some of these people are smoking when they're coming up with these theories, you know? And so in reality, we have to, by faith, believe in one thing or the other. Either evolution is true or the Bible is true. I choose to believe that the Bible is true, and the evidence for it is what we see in this world. God created the world. That's impossible, but He did it. He spoke it into existence. There are so many things that the Bible tells us are impossible that God did. Now, I want you to understand something. The resurrection literally is an impossible event, but it did occur. But I want to talk to you about the doubt among the disciples, first of all. There in Matthew 28, we didn't read all the way down to verse 16 and 17, but the Bible says the 11 disciples went away after the women came and told them that they had literally seen Jesus. It says that, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. And when they saw Him, when they saw the resurrected Savior, the Bible says they worshiped Him, but some doubted. I mean, the guy's standing there, yet some doubted. Luke 24, verse 36 through 43. Let me read these verses to you. Luke 24, 36 through 43. And as they thus spake, Jesus Himself stood in the midst of them and saith unto them, peace be unto you. Why do you think He had to say peace be unto you? Because if you saw somebody crucified like Jesus was, then suddenly they're standing in your presence, you wouldn't have peace. You'd be a little nervous. So He says, peace be unto you. But they were terrified and affrighted, and suppose that they had seen a spirit. And He said unto them, why are ye troubled? And why do thoughts arise in your hearts? Behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit hath not flesh and bones, as ye see me have. And when He had thus spoken, He showed them His hands and His feet. And while they yet believed not, for joy. It was too wonderful for them to accept as true. And wondered, He said unto them, have ye here any meat? And they gave Him a piece of a broiled fish and of an honeycomb, and He took it and did eat before them. He was trying to let them know He was real. He was alive. He could take in food. He was not a spirit. But they believed not, it says. John 20, 24. John chapter 20, verse 24 and 25. This is a story that you're all familiar with. Says, but Thomas, one of the 12, you know what happened. The other apostles had seen Jesus, but Thomas wasn't there when Jesus showed up. And so they came and told Thomas, all excited about it. Thomas, we've seen Him. He is alive. He rose like He said He was going to do. And notice Thomas's commitment to unbelief. Thomas, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto Him, we have seen the Lord. But He said unto them, except I shall see in His hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into His side, listen, I will not believe. Listen to the way He says this. Unless I can thrust my hand into the hole in His side. Thomas was angry. He was upset about the one that was his hero being now dead. And he was defiant in his doubt against the disciples who had seen Jesus. Well, you know the rest of the story. We'll reference it in a few moments. But you have doubt among the disciples there in the beginning. Then there's doubt encouraged by the deceivers. That's what we read about in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse number 12 and verse 16. How say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? For if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. You see, there's doubt because this was impossible. It could not happen. That's why there was so much doubt. It's simply an impossible thing. Although, now think about what these people saw. They had seen Jesus work miracles. They saw the Lord Jesus when He raised the widow's son, Luke chapter 7. They saw Jesus when Jairus' daughter was raised from the dead, Luke chapter 8. They saw Jesus and even got to spend time with Lazarus after Jesus stood at the grave of Lazarus 4 days after he had died and said, "Lazarus, come forth." And he got up and walked out of that grave. They saw all of that take place. But listen to me, the miracle worker was in good shape when he did those things. He had not been beaten. He had not been scourged. He had not been hung on a cross. He had not bled and died in that hot Palestinian sun. But now the miracle worker whom they had watched, they had witnessed, they saw him die. They saw his lifeless, limpless body. They scattered. They ran away and hid because Jesus had died. Now, it's one thing for him when he's alive and physically well to raise someone else from the dead. But to get up and walk out of a tomb after all he had gone through? No way. Folks, we might as well admit it. It's impossible. It truly is impossible. Bob Wright told me a story the other day I have to share with you here. He tells lots of stories. If you want to hear good stories, just hang out with Brother Bob. He's got a story about almost everything, but he was telling me about a man that had died when he was a boy. And back then, those who died would simply be placed in their own bed, and family and friends would come to the house to pay their respects and view the body. It's called a wake. That's where that term wake comes from. And just so happened, this particular man, when he did die, when he passed, he was in a curled position, kind of the fetal position. And his body had stiffened that way. And so to lay him out flat, and you always laid the person out flat on their bed, to lay him out flat, they tied ropes around him, tied some around his legs to get him down, and tied one around his upper body to get it down flat. Well, at some point, while people were gathered there in the house, that upper rope came loose, and that man sat up in bed. Now, if I had been there to preach that funeral or share something at the wake, they'd had to get somebody else. Why? Because it's impossible. Dead people do not get up and walk away. Maybe there's a story here and there like this one, but the truth is the resurrection of Jesus Christ was scientifically and physically impossible. We must admit that. However, Jesus did many things that were impossible. He healed the sick. He opened the ears of the deaf. He opened the eyes of the blind. He raised people from the dead. He walked on water. He calmed storms. He fed thousands with a small lunch. He did things that were humanly impossible. His miracles overruled or suspended the rules of natural laws of science. Why not? He created the laws of science. Jesus did the impossible while he was alive. Even the virgin birth was an impossibility for God to become man, an impossibility. But that brings us to our next point. Even though the resurrection was impossible, we also know today that it's irrefutable. There is no question that Jesus did rise. First of all, we have the eyewitness accounts. Back in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, if you want to go there, we see in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 that there were eyewitness accounts that Jesus rose from the dead. Verse number 3, Paul writes, "I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." Listen now. "And that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12, that is Peter, then the 12 saw him. After that, he was seen, listen, of above 500 brethren at once." We don't know the details of that situation, but what we do know is that Jesus appeared at some mass gathering of people. They were probably gathered to worship the Lord Jesus, to pay their respects to the one that had died. Who knows? I don't know what it was about, but they were gathered together and there was over 500 people there. And the Bible says that every one of them saw Jesus alive. And in the text, when Paul wrote these words, he says, "Of whom the greater part," that is most of them, "remain unto this present, but some are fallen asleep, some have died.
After that, he was seen of James, then of all the apostles, and last of all, a long time after his death, burial, and resurrection. In verse 8, after that, he was seen of me also as one born out of due time. Paul saw the risen Savior. You see, there are eyewitness accounts that the Bible records. And let me tell you something. We have more reason to trust this book than any other book of antiquity that's ever been discovered. There's more evidence that Jesus lived in Nazareth, that he died and rose again, than there is that George Washington did all the things that he did. You know, there's some stories about George Washington that you really have to kind of stretch your mind to really grasp. Now, I don't say they're not true. I don't say that they're false. But the truth is, people will buy into that very quickly. But then you start talking to them about Jesus that rose from the dead, and there's eyewitnesses. Listen, folks, this is valid. It is irrefutable. It's one thing to refute one eyewitness. It's a whole nother ballgame to refute over 500 eyewitnesses. Not only do we have the eyewitness accounts, but the physical examination. We go back to Thomas. Jesus offered this to the other apostles, and Thomas actually doesn't end up taking him up on it. But in the story of Thomas, when he said, "I will not believe unless," you remember that? Verse 24 of John 20 says this, "But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, 'We have seen the Lord.' But he said unto them, 'Except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, put my finger into the print of the nails, thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe.' And after 8 days again, his disciples were within, and Thomas with them." Thomas was smart enough to show up this time, right? "Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, 'Peace be unto you.' Then saith he to Thomas." Now this tells me something about Jesus. He knows what we say. He knows what we're thinking. And he knows where to find us. He came to Thomas. And I want you to notice something else, very important. Jesus refused to let Thomas go on in his doubt. He came after him. He loved Thomas in spite of that doubt. Jesus said to Thomas, "Reach hither thy finger and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless but believing." And Thomas answered and said unto him, listen, these are important words, "My Lord and my God." Thomas said, "You are my Lord, you are the boss of me, and you are the God of glory, even as you claim to be. My Lord and my God." And Jesus said unto him, "Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet believed." And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name. You see, the Lord Jesus rose. It's irrefutable. We have eyewitness testimony. There was a physical examination at least offered, but then the transformed lives of the disciples. How that their lives changed. You remember right after Jesus died on the cross, all of them went into hiding. They all went into hiding and they fled and they were, you couldn't find them even. But suddenly their attitudes changed. Suddenly they're standing in the presence of large crowds and they're preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. They're preaching the resurrection of Jesus. They're proclaiming him to be the Lord and the God and the Savior of all mankind. What made the difference? It was the resurrection of Christ. It was their eyewitness account. The Bible says in Acts 2:36, when Peter preached Jesus on the day of Pentecost, he said there, "Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly," know without hesitation, without any reservation, to know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus, listen to these words, "whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ." Who's Peter preaching to? He's preaching to the crowd that crucified Jesus. And yet with boldness, he proclaimed him to be the Savior. Later in Acts 4:13, the Bible says there, "Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled and they took knowledge of them," listen, "that they had been with Jesus." Who? They had been with the resurrected Jesus. Yes, it is impossible, but the overwhelming evidence for Christ's resurrection from the dead is irrefutable. Some of y'all know the name Lee Strobel. Lee Strobel was an award-winning author before this, an investigative reporter, but now a Christian author, award-winning author. He once considered himself to be an atheist. His wife had accepted Christ as her Savior and began working hard to win him to Jesus. He was not too keen with the change the gospel had made in his wife. In fact, he wanted his old wife back. At the time he was an investigative reporter, he decided the best way to get his old wife back was to attack her faith in the area he felt was the weakest, which was the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He put all of his investigative skills to work in order to prove the impossibility of Jesus having risen from the dead. The result, after examining the evidence in the Bible and outside of the Bible, he himself became a believer. What Strobel discovered, as well as many others, is that the evidence proves that the resurrection of Christ is irrefutable. Strobel trusted Christ as his own personal Savior, and all the work he did to disprove the resurrection became a Christian bestseller called The Case for Christ. You know, he's not the only person that has experienced that. There's been many that have experienced it. The truth is that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is irrefutable. It changed the history of the world. It proved that Jesus Christ is the promised Messiah. It ignited a flame in the faith of the fearful apostles, so much so that every one of them were persecuted for their faith, and all but one of them was martyred for their faith. And their faith, when they exhibited that, when they preached, they majored on the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now I want to ask you a question. Has the resurrection of Christ impacted your life? Has it changed who you are? Have you come to a place where you've accepted Christ, listen, as the Lord and Savior of your life? Or do you just appreciate the fact that He died for your sins and rose again? I think Jesus Christ desires more, and I think Jesus Christ deserves more. Where do you stand with Jesus today? The resurrection of Christ is too important to ignore. The resurrection of Christ cannot be denied. Listen to these words again in 1 Corinthians 15. Listen to verse 22. And as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. It goes on to say, but every man in his own order. Christ the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ at his coming. Then cometh the end. What's he talking about? The end of the world. When he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule under and all authority and power. There's coming a day when Christ will rule in this very world. For he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. The world is divided into two groups. Those who have accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior, and those who have rejected Him. The truth is, there is no middle ground. Those who receive Christ become a part of His family. Those who reject Christ, unfortunately, at some point will be considered enemies of Christ and enemies of the cross, enemies of the truth. Where do you stand with Jesus? The resurrection proves that Jesus Christ is truly the Son of God. You cannot be forgiven without Him. You cannot be saved without Him. You cannot go to heaven without Him. If you have never done so, if you have never made this decision before, I want to encourage you. In fact, if I could, I would come to you, I would kneel before you, and I would beg you to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. But no one can do it for you. In fact, God is so gracious that He will let you choose to reject the greatest gift ever offered to mankind, and that is His Son. But the rejection of that gift has awful consequences. Many of you have known the gospel, but some of you have never truly received the gospel. If you haven't done so, today would be a great day. John 1:12 says this, but as many as received Him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. It's not complicated. It's a matter of saying yes to Jesus and being sincere about it in your heart. He died for you, he was buried, and he rose again. Where do you stand with Jesus today? Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for these words in Scripture today. We believe that they are true. And Lord, these folks are gathered here, I would say, because they believe that they're true. But there may be some here. There may be some believers here who, like the apostles, for a little while, they sort of backed away. They were fearful. They didn't act as if they had faith. And yet they knew that you had promised to rise again. Lord, may the evidence presented today challenge our faith and cause us to be willing to stand boldly like the apostles did. The world at that time was even more against Christ and against the message of the gospel. It was more hostile toward the truth then than it is today. So I pray that you would help us, that our believers, we know we're saved. Lord, help us to stand boldly for Christ. Help us to do like the angel and Jesus both said to do, go and tell others about our Savior. But then, Lord, there may be some here today who have never received Jesus into their heart. I pray that today, even right now, where they're seated, before we do anything else, that they would do what Romans 10:13 says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Right in the moment, with our heads bowed and eyes closed, I pray that if there's some here today that do not know Jesus, they're not sure, they have it settled, I pray that right now in their heart, they would ask you, Lord Jesus, to come into their heart and be their Savior. Let go of the things that are holding them back and come to you. Our heads are bowed and eyes are closed. If that's you this morning and you want to invite Jesus in, you understand the choice and you want him to come into your heart and you're willing right now in your heart to ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, would you just lift your hand all over the room? If you're here today and that's you, would you lift your hand right now? I want to pray for you. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to come to you, but I do want to pray for you all over the room this morning. Pastor, pray for me. I want to invite Jesus in, and I mean business with him today. All right. Father, you know every heart. You know every need. We pray that you would use this message for your glory and honor. May it strengthen our faith in your Son. May it cause us to be bold witnesses for a risen Savior. And we'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand to your feet this morning? We're going to sing Just As I Am. If God spoke in your heart, maybe you need to be bold in your faith. Why not come and do some business here at the altar? Ask God to help you be bold. If you're here and you're still not sure, you don't have it settled, listen, I'll meet you right down here at the front. I have a baptism in just a moment, but the first couple of verses, I'm going to stand down front. Brother Isaac's going to lead us in the song, Just As I Am. God spoke in your heart. Why not come today? If you need to be saved, as we sing, you come.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to
sing another verse.
Just as I am and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to thee whose blood can cleanse its spot. Of God. just as I am, though tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, I come.
Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we're thankful for the message that we've heard this morning. Thank you for the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ that gives us the hope of eternal life. Lord, I pray still if there's someone here in this room this morning that has not trusted you as their personal Savior, Lord, before they leave this property today, Lord, I pray that they would know 100% sure, Lord, they would come, find one of us, find someone that can take the Bible and show them how they can be saved. And Lord, I pray that you would bless the remainder of our time together in Christ's name. Amen. You can be seated. We're going to get ready for baptism. We'll ask Miss Frieda if she'll play through something, and we'll get ready for baptism.
I'm standing here with Adelaide Bergen this morning. Adelaide, how old are you? She's 8 or 9. She can't remember. Just had a birthday. And so she's 9 years old. She's already a smart lady. She's telling her age younger. Anyway, Adelaide accepted Christ as her personal Savior. She's heard the gospel many times. And she recently went to her room, I believe, and prayed to receive Jesus Christ and told her parents about it. And I've talked to her about that. And she's come today to follow the Lord in believer's baptism. Adelaide, have you trusted Jesus as your personal Savior? Are you depending on Him and Him alone to take you to heaven? And is your desire to follow the Lord in believer's baptism unite with this church? All right, stand up over here. In obedience to our Lord's command, according to your profession of faith in Him, I baptize you, my little sister, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of His death, and raised to walk in newness of life. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, let's all stand. We're going to be dismissed with a word of prayer. We still have some others scheduled for baptism. Pray for them, that we'll be able to get them lined up soon. And pray for these folks that you've seen follow the Lord in believers' baptism, that they would grow in their faith. And so many of us are also witnessing to people that are not saved and that need Jesus. So please pray for us concerning that, and I hope you'll be doing the same. Brother Isaac has a little more instruction, and then he'll call on someone to come and dismiss us with the word of prayer.
All right. We are going to have our Easter egg hunt for all the young people, which is nursery grade zero, I guess you would say it that way, newborn all the way up through sixth grade. So if you are part of that age bracket, please be sure to stay for that. It's going to be out on the ball field, and so we'll need you. Please, if you are not involved with that, please kind of be watching for people and try not to run anybody over, okay? And if you are here, a young person in that age bracket, and you have not received a bucket, we have a bucket for all the young people. If you hadn't got that, there's some at the Welcome Center that you can pick up before you head out the door, but we'll enjoy hunting those eggs. It's broken down by different age brackets, so just see your age group and go into that area for the egg hunt. It's going to start 10 minutes after the closing prayer here, all right? So we'll give you the signal. So don't go out there and just start hunting eggs, or let your kids just start hunting eggs. Wait for the go signal, and that way it's fair for everyone, all right? There is cones. Let me say this, all right? And make sure, parents, that you're aware of this. There's cones scattered throughout some of the areas. You don't want to get around that, or you don't want to touch the cone or step on the cone or that area. Those are ant piles, all right? So those are fire ant piles, and we don't want you to get stung by one of those, all right? And so we've done our due diligence on marking those and treating those areas, but we just want to make sure for safety reasons that you don't get in any of those, all right? So let's have a word of prayer in closing. Brother Josh Davis, if you would come and close us in prayer. If you have any other questions, we'll be out at the Welcome Center, and just be safe. Don't run, all right? Don't hurry. 10 minutes after the service.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father God, Lord, thank you once again for the opportunity we had to be in your house today, Lord. Thank you for this day, Lord, as we can celebrate your resurrection from the dead. God, I pray that you'll be with us, Lord, as there may be a heart here that's still dealing with that decision, God, that you would continue to work in that heart and life, God, that's the most important decision that they'll ever make in this life. God, is to trust you as their Savior. God, I pray that you'll be with us, lead us, and guide us, and direct us, and bring us back at the next appointed time. In the Lord Jesus' name we pray. Amen.